Love it. Good morning, everybody. Myself, Dr. Anand Nomathulzapri, Assistant Professor, Department of ENT. Today's lecture is on juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. Hey, Datan. So it is a rare, uncommon and benign and extremely vascular tumor. This is consists of less than 1% of all head and neck tumors, that 0.5%. Usually occurs in the adolescent boys, thus commonly known as the juvenile nasal angiofibroma. Mostly seen in the age of 10 to 20 years. Average is 15 years. It is usually benign, but is locally infiltrative. This slow-growing vascular tumor arises in the spinopalatine foramen at the root of pterygoid process, lateral on the lateral nasal wall. Maxillary sinus is the most common site for extra nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. Occurs mostly often in females and at the age of around more than 40 years. Around it is extra nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. It consists mainly, it is vascular tumor. It gives blood, take blood supply from mainly from the external carotid systems. One main artery is the internal maxillary artery, which consists of which gives branches like spinopalatine arteries. Other branches are ascending pharyngeal arteries. Also, it gives some take blood supply from the internal carotid system also. What are pathologic features? We take what is macroscopic picture of this tumor. It is well-defined spongy lobulated tumor with nodules covered by nasopharyngeal mucosa, that is nodularity increases with the age. Color varies from pink as seen in nasopharynx or white or grey in exopharyngeal areas. On section, tumor is reticulated, whorled or spongy in the appearance, lacking a true capsule. Edges are sharply demarcated and easily distinguishable from the surrounding tissue. What is microscopic features? It consists of proliferating irregular vascular channels within a fibrous stroma. And vascular component is more in young tumors as increases collagen content increases. Fibrous tissue increases towards the periphery. Vascular element tend to more in the centra. Tumor blood vessel typically lack the smooth muscle and elastic fiber. This is the reason for it causes sustained bleeding. Cellular infiltration with plasma cells, lymphocyte, polymorph or eosinophils can be present. Stromal compartment consists of spindle or stellate plump cells that give rise to varying amounts of collagen, which makes some tumors very hard or firm. Mucous glands can be seen in the superficial parts of the tumor underneath the epithelial covering. How it spreads? It is, though it is benign, it causes local invasion and it spreads extensively. So tumor migrates beneath the mucous membrane. It is mainly considered submucosal spread beneath the mucous membrane of nasopharynx, displacing it towards the in process. Grows in the adjacent anatomic sites that offers less resistance and invade the cancellous bone of the basospinoid. Medially, it spread to the nasopharynx, nasal fossa, eventually toward the contralateral sides. Laterally, mainly infratemporal fossa, but via enlarged pterygopalatine maxillary fissure or pterygomaxillary fissure, typically enter a displacement in the posterior wall, maxillary wall, and contact with the masticatory muscles and cheek. Posteriorly, internal carotid via Vidian canal, cavernous sinus, or foramen rotundum to the orbital apex via inferior orbital fissure. This is spread of this tumor. mean it causes the bone involvement also, which by mainly by two mechanisms: the resorption by direct pressure of pre-existing bony structures with osteoclastic activation, direct spread along the perforating arteries into the cancellous root of pterygoid process. In advanced cases, it extends posterior toward the upper middle of clivus, laterally within the greater vein of sphenoid. Erosion of inner table of middle cranial fossa and infiltration of dura is usually rare. So, what are the different theories which associate with the JNA or theory? This mainly Ringer theory in 1938. JNA arises from the periosteum of the nasopharyngeal vault. Sommer Nepson in 1942, inequalities in the growth of the bones forming skull base resulted in the hypertrophy of underlying periosteum in response to the hormone influence. Bench and Ewing in 1941, tumor probably arose from the embryonic fibrocartilage between basiaccipit and the basisphenoid. Brunner in 1942 suggested that origin from the congenital pharyngobasilar and buccopharyngeal fascia. Stenberg again in 1942 proposed that the JNA could be a type of hemangioma, like a cutaneous hemangioma seen in the children, which regresses with the age. Osborne in 1959, it could be due to the either a hematoma or a residual fetal erectile tissue, which were subjected to the hormonal influence. Girgis and Fahmy in 1972 observed cells of nestopa and differentiated epithelial cell or zelabalan at the growing age of the angiofibromas, and so considered it is as a paraganglioma. The most accepted theory is that JNA originate from the sex steroid stimulated hamartomas tissue located in the terminate cartilage. The proposed hormonal influence explains why some JNA inulate after the puberty. The recent immunocytochemical techniques shows that androgen receptors are present in at least 75% of the tumors. These receptors are present in the both vascular and stromal component, that is testosterone receptors. Some cases progesterone receptors were found in some cases. In contrast, estrogen receptors have not been demonstrated. It may be due to the estrogen receptor concept of the alpha and beta estrogen receptors. These monoclonal antibodies may many times don't detect the beta estrogen receptors. So, estrogen receptors are not found in these cases. The proposed origin of JNA is located along the posterior lateral wall in the roof of the nasopharynx, usually in the region of superior margin of the spinopalatine foramina and posterior aspect of the middle terminate. Fetal history confirmed that large areas of the endothelial tissue in this region. Rather than inventing surrounding tissue, the tumor displaces it and distorts, relying on pressure necrosis to destroy and push through the bony confines. Intracranial extension is noted in 10 to 20% cases. JNA is seldom seen in the children below the age of 8 years. The rate of growth of the tumor and period of maximum development coincide with the rate of erectile tissue of the penis, both increasing size during the period of sexual development. So, what are different clinical features? Age mostly seen in the 10 to 25 years male, average is 15 years. Cardinal feature is mainly nasal obstruction and the intermittent nasal bleeding of epistaxis. Others, which consist of anemia, hyposmia, anosmia, nasal intonation of voice, deafness, otalgia due to the serous otitis media, this causes the eustachian block on that particular side, headache, and extensive lesion, nasal bones becomes splayed out, swelling in the temple and cheek, if it causes extension in the infratemporal fossa or pterygomaxillary fossa or fissure. In intraoral palpation between the ascending rhamus of the mandible and side of maxilla may reveal thickening of the disease which has crept around the back of antrum. Trismus or bulging of parotid if impactation of bulky mass in the infratemporal fossa. Proptosis if orbital fissures are penetrated. Frog face appearance if massive escape of disease involving the ethmoid. On enterorhinoscopy, endoscopy examination we do in which reveals a mass in the nasal cavity. Color varies from pink to white. Parts in the nasopharynx are invariably pink, whereas the part that escape to the extra pharyngeal areas are often white or grey. The appearance of the tumor mass tend to reflect its vascularity and may appear pale white if predominantly composed of the fibrous tissue, or dark red or fleshy if it is vascular. Spread of the tumor is by submucal extension through the local tissue and planes of the least resistance. Location, most commonly arise from the spilopendal forming area. It may have two components, one filling the nasopharynx, other extending out into the pterygomandibular or intratemporal fossa. The central stalk joining the two components occupy the spinopendent foramen and the upper end of the vertical plate of the palatine bone. Diagnosis by history and by after that endoscopy examination we usually do, which shows the rubbery vascular mass that protrude into the anterior nasal space, may have excessive bleeding on contact. Since epidermal and endoscopy finding a typical biopsy is absolutely contraindicated because of consider an undue risk of the massive hemorrhage. So we usually don't take quick biopsy. We rely on the history, endoscopy finding and CT finding. So what are other investigations by plain lateral X-ray of skull? Obesity in the scene in the paranasalis may be seen, maybe nasopharynx can be seen. Anterior bowing of the posterior wall of maxillary sign can be seen. It is known as Hallmann-Miller sign. Nowadays, diagnosis basically on the CT and MR appearance that sometimes confirmed by the angiography. Biopsy contraindicated because of hemorrhage. Usually, diagnosis imaging is based on the three factors: site of origin, hypervascularization of after contrast enhancement, pattern of growth. CT scan with contrast usually preferred. Enhancing soft tissue mass arising from the nasopharynx or lateral wall of nose, the repalatine fossa may be invaded by tumor. Bone erosion not present in general. In MRI, vascular tumor with flow of voids within mass that enhance on gadolinium imaging. Some signs are present in CT scan. This Hallmann-Miller sign shows in 80% cases, which consists of anterior bowing of the posterior wall of the maxillary sinus. And Hondusa sign, widening of the gap between the ramus of mandible and maxillary body. On MRI, a rich vascularity of tumor gives rise to a typical small dotted flow of voids, which is called as salt paper appearance. Angiography, again a gold standard for this. Bilateral vascular supply around 36 pace, hence both current system requires angiographic evaluation. Assess vascular supply of the JNA, allows embolization feeding vessel prior to surgery, more as surgical treatment adjuvant via possibility of embolization rather than diagnostic tool. MRI angiography is least invasive from the vascular imaging that will show the main feeding vessels. Vascular blush is seen in postnasal space and adjacent areas diagnostic. However, final diagnosis is after the surgery and histopath. So what are different staging proposed? Many stagings are proposed for this JNA, mainly consists of Chandler's, Fish, Andrews and Radakowski. Fish is most robust and practical, defines clearly which surgical approach is required. Radakowski appeals to those involved with management of small tumor as there are more subdivisions. So what is Fish staging? Tumor limited to the nasopharyngeal cavity. Bone distance negligible or limited to the spinopalatine foramen. This is grade 1. What is grade 2? Tumor invading the pterygopalatine fossa or maxillary ethmoid or spinoid sinus with bone destruction. Grade 3 is tumor invading the infratemporal fossa or orbital region without intracranial involvement is a grade 3A, and 3B is with intracranial extradural or paracellular involvement, and 4th is intracranial intradural tumor. 4A is without implantation of the cavernous sinus, pituitary fossa or optic chiasm, or 4B is with implantation of the cavernous sinus, pituitary fossa or the optic chiasm. Again, Radakowski classification of JNA is 1A consists of the limited to the nose and nasopharyngeal area, 1B is extension into one or more sinuses, 2A is minimal extension in the pterygoid fossa, 2B is occupation of the pterygoid fossa without orbital erosion, 2C, infratemporal fossa extension without cheek or pterygoid plate involvement. Three is erosion of the skull base with middle cranial fossa or pterygoids, and 3B is erosion of the skull base with intracranial extension with or without cavernous involvement. Andrew staging is, stage 1 is tumor limited to the nasal cavity. Stage 2 is tumor extension into the pterygoidal fossa or maxillary sphenoid or ethmoid sinus. Stage 3A is tumor extension into the orbit without intracranial involvement. Stage 3B is stage 2A with the extradural or paracel or intracranial involvement. 4A is intradural without cavernous sinus, pituitary or optic chiasm involvement. 4B is involvement of the cavernous sinus, pituitary or optic chiasm. Surgery is usually recommended stage up to the 4A, while for stage B, radiation surgery is advisable. So it is not resectable after 4A. Other stagings are Biller staging, and Biller staging consists of T1, T2 and T4. But what is T1? Is tumor in nasal and paranasal sinus except sphenoid with or without erosion of the bone. T2 is tumor extension into the orbit or protruding into the anterior cranial fossa. T3 is tumor involvement in brain, that is resectable with the margins. T4 is tumor is unresectable. What is Chandler's? Stage 1 is tumor is confined to the nasopharynx. Stage 2 is extends into the nasal cavity or sphenoid. Stage 3 is tumor involves maxillary sinus, ethmoid sinus, infratemporal fossa, orbits, cheeks and cavernous sinus. Stage 4 is tumor is intracranial. So what are differential diagnosis of GNA? It should be differentiated from the unilateral nasal masses, that is from the pyogenic granulomas, enterocondylar polyps, angiomatous polyps or hemangiomatous polyps, nasopharyngeal cyst, chordomas and carcinomas. So what is treatment? Usually treatment is surgical resection. So what are general surgical principles? The surgical approaches are depend on the tumor location and the extent, pattern of the vascular supply, effectiveness of embolization, facial skeletal maturity and experience of the surgical team. GNA may be resected by the endoscopic, open or combined approaches. Nowadays mostly endoscopic approach is preferred. So endoscopic sinus surgery technique mainly is a surgical resection in present era. Advantage is it gives magnified view of lesion related to the anatomic structures from the multiple angles, better identification of the interface between lesion and soft tissue or adjacent bones, allows more accurate and complete dissection and better control of the bleeding. So what are indications? Tumor involving nasal cavity, paranasal sinus, nasopharynx, tumors with only medial infratemporal fossa involvement or extradural paracel involvement with limited intracranial extension. Facilities of open chapters should be present there. Relative contraindications are lateral infratemporal fossa involvement, extension in the paracellar region, encasement of optic nerve involvement, intradural spread or cavernous sinus involvement. These are relative contraindications. What are complications? Pain, bleeding, chances of infection, hyposmia, synergy formation, orbital injury which causes loss of vision, CSF leak, intracranial injury, tumor recurrence or recidivism if margins are not cleared properly. Some centers open operations are also preferred or done. Tumors that extend into the intratemporal fossa, tumors with intradural extension in centers that lack endoscopic expertise in conjunction with the endoscopic resection, that anterior antrostomy or cardioid loop may be employed to gain access to the and clip the internal maxillary artery. So what are different surgical approaches? Mainly Wilson approach, which is transpalatal approach. Sardana approach is transpalatal plus sublabial. Transpalatal transantral is Denker's. Transmandibular pterygoid is Kerman approach. Transzygomatic, transhyoid, transendoscopic. Endoscopic approach mainly involves the modified Denker approach. Trans-cervical, transmandibular approach, and that is Biller's approach. Transmandibular is Liefeld 1 approach. Lateral anatomy with medial maxillotomy. Butterfly subgrovous incisions, mid-facial degloving. These are infratemporal fossa approaches. These are different open surgical approaches where endoscopic facility is not available, can be done. This is according to grading. If type 1, type 2, Andrews transnasal endoscopy approach, usually nowadays up to 4A we can do that endoscopic approach. Tumor extending to max and mid facial degloving can be done. Tumor extending into the ethmoid sinus, lateral anatomy approach can be done. Tumor extending into the intranasal cavity of maxillary sinus, erosion on the posterior wall of sinus, Weaver Ferguson incision. Tumor extending to the ethmoid spinoid complex involving the anterior skull base, bicoronal incision and anterior canal facial dissection. Type 3 and 4, grade 3 and 4, lateral skull base approach via postoperative and with postoperative lithotripsy. Tumor with major extension in front of fossa, midline mandibulotomy combined with the transpalatine exposure. All these are different approaches as convenient to the surgeon and facility available to that at the center. Usually nowadays, in transendoscopic approach, endoscopic approach is preferred, and it is very good for avoid the recurrences and control the bleeding. What are different adjuvant therapies? Preoperative embolization is done in some centers where facilities are available. It reduces the intraoperative bleeding. It may shrink the tumor. Enables a better resolution of the surgical field. That the endoscopic setting facilitates the dissection. However, risk of recurrence is increased. It's up to the 40% risk of recurrence where the embolization is done. So nowadays, it is done in some centers. Tumor shrinkage makes border ill-defined, leads to the inadequate resection. Done 24 or 70 hours before or preoperatively the surgery. It may cause strokes, visual loss, facial paralysis. Carotid dissection may occur if feeders from the IC embolize. What difference here? Gel foam is used, polyvinyl alcohol is used, coils, microparticles, liquid glue, onyx, that is ethylene vinyl alcohol, copolymer. These are different substances which is used in the for embolization. It shows the deep penetration in the tumor. It is onyx is nowadays preferably in all. It shows the deep penetration in the tumor, more extension, tumor necrosis, embolization of large portion of the tumor via fewer catheterization, and safe withdrawal of the catheter. Limiting factors which for successful embolization is vessel toxicity, vasospasm, prior sacrifice of internal maxillary artery or external carotid artery, more serious complication, loss of vision secondary to the occlusion of the central retinal artery, direct intratumoral embolization under the radiographic control if it is not accessible. Hormonal therapy, tumor enlargement with administration of the testosterone shrinkage with the estrogen therapy. This is flutamide, orally active non-steroidal androgen antagonist. Gates et al. Suggested that tumor reduction in 44% cases, 4 of the 4 cases receiving 6 weeks of the treatment course. Labra et al. Tumor reduction in only 11.1% cases in 6 cases receiving the 3-week treatment course. Current recommendation is 6 weeks of course of flutamide as adjuvant therapy in post-pubertal patients. Radiation therapy for tumor that recur after the surgery, those with the intracranial extension, that is 4B, where clearance of the margin may be difficult, usually 3,000 to 5,500 grays in 15 to 18 over 3 to 3.5 weeks. Tumor regression is very slow over 2 to 3 years. by the radiation it vasculitis and occlusion of vessel by perivascular the fibrosis. Intensity modulated radiotherapy creates the confrontal dose distribution to the minimize the dose to the adjoint tissue. Has been used to deliver 3,400 to 4,500 grays to patient with extensive disease involving the cavernous sinus, skull base. Proton radiotherapy creates even tighter dose distribution, further reduce risk of the late effects. Stereotactic radiosurgery for minimal, well-defined residual tumor following the incomplete resection. Disadvantage, risk of the marginal miss because of necessity of tight dose of distribution, higher risk of late complication. What are different complications of radiotherapy? Up to 33% it causes growth retardation, panhypopituitarism, temporobone necrosis, cataract, radiation keratopathy, thyroid and nasopharyngeal malignancies. So what are complications of JNA? Mostly after surgery is recurrence. So most common complication is recurrence. More likely in patients with advanced disease and those treated by inexperienced surgeons, mainly in younger patients, usually develop as a consequence of invasion of basal sphenoid. Disease-free status after 5 years after primary surgery probably represent the cure. So you have to follow up this patient thoroughly at least for the 5 years. Infarbed nerve sensory deficit and nasal vestibular stenosis as a complication of mid-facial deglowing surgery. Prolonged nasal crusting may develop into the ozona, which lead to atrophic rhinitis. So, regular nasal douching with saline and the use of glucose in glycerin drops is important in these cases. Ocular problems with more extensive resection, displacement of the globe caused by loss of bony support, ophthalmoplegia, visual loss. These are different complications of JNA after surgeries. Thank you. Sir?